Hello, viewers, and thank you very much for joining us once again on The People Show, your inspirational show that brings you stories of people who have wrought change in our society, people who've given their life to make sure that other people will live a better or a comfortable life, if you want to say. Today, we have with us in studio a very special guest. The name of our guest today is Mr. Maurice Odhiambo. Maurice Odhiambo is the founder and also the director of the Mana Ministries International. Thank you very much for accepting our invitation to the studio.
Yes, thank you.
Karibu sana. Now, probably maybe our viewers would want to know, who is Mr. Maurice Odhiambo? What's his background? Where did he come from?
Mr. Maurice Odhiambo is, I was born in Kisumu Rural, yes, in a place called Seme. Mm-hmm. And I grew up there in the village as a young boy. Currently, Maurice is a father.
Right.
Maurice is a father of four children. Mm-hmm. Maurice is a husband. And Maurice is a preacher, a teacher of the Word of God, mm-hmm, and an evangelist.
All right.
Acts chapter number 1, verse 8, describes my life and ministry.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Would you kindly share that with our viewers?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Acts chapter 1, verse 9.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you will be my witnesses when the Holy Spirit has come upon your life,
right,
both in Jerusalem, in Samaria, and even to the uttermost parts of the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And that is what motivates me. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Now, Maurice, let's go back a little bit. You mm-hmm said you grew up in the rural areas, Seme to be in particular.
Yeah.
Seme is just about 5 or 6 kilometers away from my hometown.
Oh, really?
So I know a little bit about the,
okay,
the place. Which part of Seme?
It's called Kitimikai sub-location. It's just
sub-location,
adjacent. Actually, my home and our mission center is adjacent to the big Kitimikai historic rock.
Yeah, yeah.
So that is where I grew up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit, what was it like growing up in the village and what kind of family were you brought up in?
Growing up in the Seme village, it was actually fun.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to be honest that the family that I was grown up in was one of family with a lot of challenges. With the, it was a family, I came up from a very poor background,
right,
where my dad and mom had, we have a lot of siblings.
Mm-hmm.
We had about, my mother has given birth to 19, and we are
19
eight,
children?
Yes, and 11 of them died, and 8 of us are still alive.
Okay.
And it was really hard even for my parents to be able to put a meal on the table for the family.
Are you the oldest among your siblings?
Yes, I'm the oldest among our siblings.
All right.
So as a result of that, my dad could not manage to take me to school.
All right.
So I was only able to get to class 8, and that is where my education got to an end. So I'm a class 8 dropout,
mm-hmm,
as a result of the poverty and as a result of lack in my family.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Now, Maurice, talking about this, of course, you're going to tell us about what you're doing right now.
Yeah.
Dropping out at class 8. Then at that time, at that point,
mm-hmm,
what was left for your life? What did you do with your life after realizing that you cannot continue your education?
Well, Mr. Tim, I actually almost gave up. I actually gave lost hope in life,
yes,
when I dropped out, because there was a grandpa of mine who promised that if I continue to work hard in school, that he was going to take care of my education, future education. And that was as a result of when he looked at my family, there was not anyone that could continue with educating me.
Oh, yeah.
So I really worked hard, and my entire education in primary school, I was the best in all the classes. And I was very hopeful that I would continue. But when I had to drop down, to drop from class 8 and there was no hope for me, I lost hope. And the only thing I knew I would do best was to do the work that my father did without education, and that was to go to Moroni,
mm-hmm,
and cut sugarcane and weed sugarcane.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually went there and I started doing that work. And during that time is when I started to think about my life. And I said, is this really the life that God would want me to live? As a child of God. And that is how I came to find out that there is the me that the people know I am, depending, determined by where I'm coming from, determined by my parents.
Yes.
And there was a me that I believe I was, And that was determined by the challenges that I'm going through, by the level of my education, the people that I'm connected to. Mm-hmm. And I also realized that there was the third me that God says I am and that God created me to be. Mm-hmm. And that is the point that I had to choose the me that I wanted to live. And I had to choose that I wanted to live the me that God says I am. And that is what brought the turnaround in my life.
Tell us about the turnaround. At what age did you realize all this? Did all this come to you that you have this choice to choose what kind of life you wanted to live?
Yeah, it was at the age of 19 years old. That is after I had completed my, dropped out of the school in class 8 in 1993. Yes. And I went to Moroni. And it was that life that I was going to lead, the life that I was going to depend on the kind of jobs that only people that have not education can be able to do. That is cutting of sugarcane and all that kind of bad work.
Of course, you don't need any education to cut and weed.
Yes, so I was doing that. And I saw my dad doing it without education. Yes. So that was where I was going to live all my life. But then I started to analyze the life of my father, who could not even provide enough meal for us, take us to school. And I said to myself, is this the kind of life that I want to live? And then that is when I said, no, I want a different life. And I said, like, if I want a different life, then how? What am I going to do? Because in the world where we live now, mm-hmm. education is very key.
Sure.
And I didn't acquire it because you acquire it with money. That is when the Lord brought a verse in my heart and Proverbs, I think Proverbs 10:9 or 9:10, that says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
Sure.
And that is when God showed me that, Maurice, I know you have not been able to acquire the education, but there is one mm-hmm. that you can be able to acquire. But the condition is, you have a connection with me. And that is when I gave my life to Jesus at the age of 17 years old. And I said, I want to live for God, and I want to access that knowledge that has taken me so far where I am today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So did you go to any kind of college to study the Bible or something, or did you just get connected to a church and started living your spiritual life?
My father is a pastor.
All right.
From my childhood. Mm-hmm. And that is one of the things that made me not to give my life to Jesus until a very late age, at the age of 18, yeah. 17. And my father was born in my home. As my father being a pastor, I should have given my life earlier.
Sure.
But I hated Christianity because my dad is a pastor who goes away to preach and comes back and not able to provide for the family. And I was like, this God is taking away my dad and keeping him busy and not giving him time to support our family. Mm-hmm. And so that is really what took place.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Now, Maurice, then how did you come to leave Moroni? And when you left Moroni, where did you go?
When I left Moroni, my uncle, he said that he told my mother mm-hmm. that he was going to take me to driving school.
Uh-huh.
Where I used to go to school in primary school is just close to a road. And I used to see Makanga, mm-hmm. the Matatu Toots, they were doing the job.
Yes.
And that was the job I really desired. And I really wanted to do driving course uh-huh. so that I can be able to drive Matatu. So my uncle asked my mother, and my mother told her that I can be able to do the toot. So he said he was going to come and sponsor me to go to a driving school. When I came to Nairobi, he turned against me and said, Maurice, I have no money, so you have to go to Mjengo. So I did Mjengo construction.
So you lived with him during that time?
Yes, I lived with him in Kibera
mm-hmm.
Slums. And so I lived there in
Which
Kibera.
Which year is that?
In 1994
mm-hmm.
Through to the year 2001. That is when I left Kibera. So okay. I stayed in Kibera for 7 years. Yeah, so I started doing construction work, kazi ya mkono,
yes.
And I did it for quite a long time because that is what my uncle could offer me.
Yes.
So I did it until when I got an opportunity because I was connected to the church
mm-hmm.
To go to a printing farm that was being operated by Deliverance Church.
Okay.
So I was going there to cook tea and to clean the floor mm-hmm. and the toilet. And that is the work that I did for quite about 3 years mm-hmm. When I was doing that kind of a job. And then as I was doing the job, I could go to the printing workshop mm-hmm. and I could see my uncle. He was working there
oh.
using the printing machine operator, the machine. And I took the advantage without the information, the information of the owner of the company, the information of my uncle, and I learned how to print. So after just about 6 months, someone left the place, left the machine, and I went to the boss and said, boss, I can use this machine. And he said, no, you can't. But then when the guy delayed, someone brought in the job, and there was no one to do it, and I came in and I did it. And I got employed as a printing machine operator for the first time.
So, fast forward. Now you've gotten this job as a operating the printer machine. How then did it turn out that now you came to do what you're doing today? What followed after that?
Well, I did that printing machine operator for some time, and my boss, he always thought that I got to know the job from his company, so he was paying me quite little money. Yeah. But then I continued to get involved with my Christian work because I said this is what caused the turnaround in my life. So my relationship with Jesus continued, and God continued to use me that I was willing, like I said, I was going out to share about my faith, about the love of God with other people. Yeah. Sometimes I missed the job. So my boss one day and his wife called me and said, Maurice, we want you to decide today if you are going to serve God or serve us, because you are here for making money for our company.
Sure.
So if you are going to do your ministry going here and there, then you have to go. If you are going to be here, then you're going to serve the company.
Okay.
Then I chose that I'm going to serve God, and that is why how I left my job. Since 2001, my wife and complained.
Yeah.
She thought I did a mistake.
You married then?
Yes.
I was married with two kids. Two kids?
Yeah.
Then quitting your job, how did you manage to survive and provide for your family?
It was all going to be in the hands of God, because the question that I was given by my boss was really tricky.
Yeah.
Because he tells me, you are here, the relationship we had is to make money for my company. Now you are always out there, and you are not making profit for the company. So you are going to choose. Are you going to serve that God, or are you going to serve the company?
Oh.
So the only option I had was to say, I'm going to serve God, and I was going to keep my life in the hands of God to provide for me and to prove to me that he is the one who made my life to be changed.
Was your boss a believer? I mean, you say the printing machine was within of the church.
He was a believer, and eventually, after I left, he eventually became a pastor.
Whoa.
Yeah, he did not want to become a pastor, but when one of the churches, the pastor left, the congregation demanded that the pastor we want is him. If not him, then we don't want a pastor. And right now, he went, joined the pastor. Actually, he sold a lot of things, of his properties, invested in that church where he was, and he became a pastor. And that church is really doing so good. He called me later. We have met. We are best friends.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, yeah.
He was like a springboard for you to, you know, get to another level. I mean, if you had worked for him more, or if he would have left you to that, you wouldn't have made the decision of actually going independent and experiencing God firsthand.
Yeah, I considered it to be God, and that is why I love my boss so much, even now. Because it reminds me of Joseph and his brothers who sold him to a foreign land. They thought that was the end of his life. But in all the workings, God was working through this, the brothers of Joseph to be a vehicle that would carry Joseph from Canaan, which was a nomadic land, to Egypt, where it was a king. There was a setup of kings, because Joseph was promised that he was going to become a king or a prime minister.
Exactly.
But he could not become that in Canaan, because there was no kings in Canaan.
Wow.
So I believe that this was all set by God for me to, it was set by God for to use my boss to get me from where I was to where God wanted me to be.
Now, let's come to the point where you start your organization. How did this come to start? And what motivated you to do that?
What motivated me to start the Manna Ministries International? I was motivated by the love of God towards me. I looked back in my life after God had blessed my life, and I thought that I did not deserve this kind of love from God, because I was uneducated and I had no one that was important in my life. And I was raised in from a very poor background. But when, even with all that, God accepted me and showed his love towards me and changed me and made me to be who I am. Mm-hmm. That is what motivated me to start something that was going to spearhead spreading the same love to people that are suffering, are needy, and think that the society have neglected them. Mm-hmm. So the love of God towards me motivated me to start what I'm doing today.
So probably the beginning of MANA Ministries International was as a result of what you went through.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I just want you to hold that thought, because we're going to go for a short break.
Okay.
But when we come back, I want us to now look into the MANA Ministries right. International. What kind of a ministry is it? What kind of activities are you engaged in? How do you relate with mm-hmm. the public and the society at large?
Okay.
Now, viewer, if you're just joining us, we are with a very special guest today, who shared with us his life story. From a very poor background, he has turned out to be a leader of an organization that is actually working wonders in the lives of many, training pastors and doing a lot of works for the society as well. We are talking with none other than Maurice Odhiambo, the founder and director of the MANA Ministries International. We'll now take a short break. If you have any comments, suggestions, or opinion, you can send that to our short SMS line. That's 21144. 21144. Don't touch that dial. We'll be right back after this break.
MANA Ministries International was launched in 2001 by Maurice Odhiambo as the founder and director, with the aim of giving hope to the hopeless. Providing educational facilities and food to orphans who are affected by extreme poverty and HIV and AIDS. This is done through giving widows food, housing, and also capital for those who are viable to start a business. Identifying and training specific people in theology.
My name is Maurice Odhiambo Dindo, and I'm the founding director of MANA Ministries International, a non-denominational organization that was founded in the year 2001 when I felt the Lord's calling upon my life. And we started in a humble beginning. It was not that much that the Lord showed to me, but as time goes, the Lord has been unfolding the vision and expanding it beyond my expectations.
Welcome back. If you're just joining us, you're watching The People Show, a show that brings you inspirational stories, stories of people who are determined to see to it that our society or the community that we live in becomes a better place and a conducive place for everybody, no matter their background or where they come from. Today we have with us in studio Maurice Odhiambo, who is the director and also the founder of the MANA Ministries International. We've just shared with him about his past life, where he came from, and from a very humble background, he has grown to be someone who is actually now running a ministry that is helping many, not just orphans, but also training pastors. And he's going to tell us more about that. Welcome back to the show.
Thank you,
Maurice.
Yeah.
Now, during the break, you're just telling me about the kind of activities that you guys engage in. Maybe you can just share that with our viewers right now. What are the main activities that you guys at the MANA Ministries International do?
MANA Ministries International, we began it in 2001. Mm-hmm. And we began it to serve the body of Christ in evangelism, discipleship, which is our major focus as a ministry, mm-hmm. Which actually we have been able to use to plant churches across the region. In other countries besides Kenya too.
Okay.
Also to serve the body of Christ in pastoral training that we do through conferences, mm-hmm. As well as church planting that we also do. And also community development programs to be able to help the needy and the suffering in our community.
When we talk about community development, I want us to talk a little bit about that before we get back to the pastoral trainings that you have and the planting of churches.
Mm-hmm.
About community development, we know that one of the key areas or key obstacles that have actually made our society or our community a place that a lot of crime and immorality have grown rampantly over the past years, is the issue of poverty and lack of empowerment within our community setups. When you talk about community development, what exactly do you guys do on the ground?
What we do, the side of the widows program, mm-hmm. we have 150 widows in Kisumu region alone.
All right.
And we also have started putting together some widows in Nairobi in the slums. Mm-hmm. And this is as a result of my experience with my grandma, what she had to go through. Mm-hmm. And what we are doing with the widows every month, we are distributing foodstuffs to each one of these widows mm-hmm. that is able to take them through the entire month.
Oh.
Most of these widows are those that are elderly, and some of them are disabled and are not able to take care of themselves. And for those who are still strong, mm-hmm. as a ministry, we train them on how to do small businesses.
All right.
And we help some of them to do farming businesses and maybe small businesses.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing that we do with the widows is we build homes for them.
Mm-hmm.
There are some of these widows due to tradition and cultural or whatever. The homes that was left for them with their husbands have become very bad,
mm-hmm.
and they cannot repair it. So we have been able to come in to repair and build a lot of homes for so many widows, not only in Seme,
mm-hmm.
but in various places across our nation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you mentioned something about orphans as well.
Yes, yes.
And you have this program where you take care of orphans and educate them. To what level do you educate your orphans, and how do they get connected to your ministry?
We use the local authority in Kisumu Rural,
mm-hmm.
where we have the orphanage school.
All right.
They are able to help us identify the children with most plight need who are left orphans. And what we do, we give them education free in our Mana Academy mission in Kisumu. And we also feed them meals every day. And we also support their guardians who stays with them to be able to feed them when they get back home in the school.
Mm-hmm.
Our school gets to the level of class 8.
Okay.
And then after class 8, we are able to identify children who have done well.
Mm-hmm.
And we take them to high school, and we continue to support them whenever we are able.
Oh, yeah.
What we do, we try to find sponsors for each of these children.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the children that we started with in this program are right now are in the university. Like we have some of these students in Technical University.
Right.
We have some in Maseno. And we have some who have been through Aviation College and other, depending on what grade that they got.
Mm-hmm.
And we also have even people that works with us,
mm-hmm.
Like our administrator, who had to go through Mana Ministries getting help to do the course at the Nairobi Aviation at Business Administration.
Right.
And he's eventually now one of our staffs in Mana
Missions. So he's someone who actually went through your program?
Yes.
He's now working for you?
Yes.
But even after getting, of course, professional training in a
yes.
learning institution?
Yes.
For how long has the home or this program run, specifically the one for orphans? For how long have this been going around? Because if you have guys up to the level of university.
What happened is we did not start helping the children from the Mana Academy.
All right.
Mana Academy came in as a result of the overwhelming need to support the children.
All right.
We were not able to support all of these children in primary school.
Mm-hmm.
So we decided to start our own primary school so that we can only remain with those who have passed primary school that we can support going in other schools.
Mm-hmm.
So Mana Academy only started in the year 2009.
Okay.
But the program we started long way ago in the year 2000, around 2004.
Okay.
That is when our first children that we took in, we started to support.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So according to what you told me, I come to realize that where is your biggest base in terms of operation? You operate in, of course, Western Kenya, Seme and Kisumu area. And also you have other programs running in Nairobi. Where specifically in Nairobi?
Our ministry's headquarters is based in Nairobi here.
Okay.
And we also do a lot in Nairobi.
Mm-hmm.
We are currently conducting feeding programs
mm-hmm.
in the slums of Nairobi, feeding about 3,000 from 26 schools.
Okay.
That is spread across various slums in Nairobi. We feed them two meals a day.
Mm-hmm.
And also, besides that, because our main goal is to be able to lead every child to Christ, through our charitable services, we have been able to create jobs to the young people through creating chaplaincy, whereby we have individual people that are assigned to each of these schools, that they go to these schools and teach them about God's word.
All right.
Every week they go two times, and we pay them in our in our ministry,
all
through
right.
our ministry.
Right.
So when we have 26 schools, then it means we have created also employment opportunity for about 26 young men that goes out there. They serve the children, they get to see, experience what these children have to go through in the slums and give back to them. And as a ministry, we motivate them to be able to do that.
Many people start such organizations, and I'll be very honest with you, probably to get money from donors, because, I mean, come, take a picture with the kids, send it abroad, money will come. What is your take on this, and how does your ministry operate to ensure that you actually do this for the children and not just for personal gain?
Well, I believe that my case is so unique because of what motivated me to, for example, start supporting the orphans or feeding the orphans in the slums.
Yes.
I can remember that before I got partners that would help us feed the children, like the No Hungry Children that works with us in the slums, I and my wife, we started by ourselves. We bought plastic chairs, we were renting them out, and the proceeds would come, we put together at the end of the month, we would take that and go feed seven schools. So seven schools were being fed by us.
Out of your own?
Out of our own money.
Yes.
We did not have enough or much money, but we were doing it because it was a calling, it was a burden in us. That is because my wife grew up as an orphan as well, and me, I grew up out of that kind of a challenge. I wished someone was somewhere to come and help me continue with my education or feed me. So when I was in this position, I said to myself that I want to provide to the children who are not able to get what they want, because I wished someone would have done that for me. And that is why, as for me, it is something that I do as a passion. It's a burden. I feel that I am living when I'm just giving back to them. And I'm not doing it because of what somebody would do for me. I do it with or without donors.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Looking at your profile, I also understand that you have a band that you brought together where youth can actually do this. How did this come about? Do you love music? Do you sing yourself?
Yeah, when I gave my life to Jesus, I did not give my life to Jesus as a result of a preacher who preached the word. I gave my life to Jesus when somebody sang a song, and I heard that song, it spoke to me, and I just found myself going forward and giving my life to Jesus. I love singing, and when I was still a young man, I used to sing in the church. These young people that I brought together to be able to find a stage to sing and equip and do better for their talents, these are people that I realized they had a lot of challenges with the churches. Some pastors did not understand them. So they kept moving from this church to the other one and to the other one. And their reputation were getting worse. They had talents, they had songs that they had written, and nobody was caring about it. So this is when God led me to come in and prove to the community, prove to the church that these young men need mentorship. They need people who can appreciate them. They need people who can see what is in them and just sharpen it and help them to come out. That is why I brought together Mana Band. And since then, it's a group of 16 young people that now all of them came into Mana Band when they had not done any album. But now almost each one of them have got an album, and some of them, we watch them on televisions. Our Password and all that. They have won awards and,
The likes of who?
The likes of Emma Omonge, Willie Nzita, and I have even been able to invest when Willie Paul was launching You Never Know album.
All right.
I wrote him a check.
Wow.
Yes, to do to be able to do that song. To do whatever part of that song.
Such an amazing work that you're doing. Maybe before we end, I would like to give you a few minutes, just 2 minutes, to answer two questions. 10 years from now, where do you see your organization? Before you answer that, what challenge would you give to ministers who are working with young people? Yes, giving the word of God is good, but also motivating them with what they can do, because young people have a lot of talent. They have a lot of energy, and they want an area or a place to channel this, this energy that they have. What challenge would you pose to ministers out there or ministries who have young people and are not giving them the chance to do that? And where do you see your organization 10 years from now?
First of all, on the young people in relation to the leaders, especially church leaders, I would want to challenge our church leaders that they should not feel insecure when they see the young people, God raising the young people in their congregation. I want to remind them that God has a place for each and everyone in the body of Christ. Even if God raises a young man in your congregation, God already has a place for them.
Sure.
And that place, you cannot play the same place. So you need to give them chance.
Yes.
You need to bring them up, support them, encourage them. And more so, you need to be able to appreciate what God is doing through their lives,
mm-hmm.
so that you do not feel insecure when they come up. Because at the end of the day, you will be proud to see a young man, God raising them up, and they are identifying with you.
Mm-hmm.
So insecurity is one of the worst thing that is really affecting our young people,
mm-hmm.
because everybody is insecure,
sure.
about someone that God is raising.
Wow.
And MANA, as a mission, in the next 10 years, what we want to see, we are looking at identifying more talents among the young people and helping them realize their life's purpose,
mm-hmm.
and be able to walk in their life's purpose. We are also looking at seeing the people that we support now growing up and getting the required education and being equipped to be able to take places, their position, not only in the church, but in the society. I want to see some MPs, some doctors, some
material of MANA.
Of MANA. And we are very confident that it is going to take place.
30 seconds, because we have already run out of time. My director is all over my ears telling me to wind up. I want you to look straight into that camera and talk to our viewer at home. Just 30 seconds, a word of encouragement.
Well, I want to just encourage someone there that it doesn't matter what you don't have. It doesn't matter where you come from. It doesn't matter what people think of you. What matters is what God says about your life. And if you can identify your life's purpose, then you can become what nobody can make you to become.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Bwana Morris, for coming and sharing with us your story.
Yes.
Very inspirational.
Yes, yeah.
Personally, I'm touched.
Mm-hmm.
Because of lack of time, I think I'll share with you my story after
okay.
this show. Viewer, we have come to the end of our show today. And what a story. I mean, as our brother Morris just said, your background is not important. What people think about you, how they see you, is not important. It's what God has purposed for you
mm-hmm.
that is important. It's upon you, our viewer at home, to ask yourself, do you live by what people say or what your background is
mm-hmm.
or by what God has pronounced about your life? That brings us to the end of our show today. Thank you very much for staying tuned. If you have any comments, suggestions, or opinion, you can send that to our SMS line. That's 21144. 21144 is the number. Thank you very much once again. Do have yourself a lovely time, and let's meet again at the same place. Bye-bye for now.